Welcome, everybody. Brother Dan Goodwin here, Prophecy in the News. Glad to have you with us again. I have in the studio here a guest, Brother Sheldon, Pastor Sheldon from Tennessee. And he has written a brand new book called The Terror of the Lord. It's called The Terror of the Lord, Expanding Our Understanding of the Character of God. Brother Sheldon, it's good to have you in the studio with us today. And
thank you.
And we want to know a little bit about you before we get into this book. Very interesting book, by the way. I have read it. I made a lot of highlighted marks in here. I got to be honest, a very sobering book. And we're going to talk about this book today. And I hope that we can get through to the audience the seriousness of what's in here, the terror of the Lord. But before we do that, I'd like for the folks to know a little bit about you. So let me read the back here, and then I'll let you tell us a little bit more about yourself. But on the back of the book, it says Reverend Mark Sheldon has been a pastor for over 20 years. He has served as a chaplain to the Nashville Union Rescue Mission, as well as in nursing homes in the Middle Tennessee area. He also served on the mission board of the Nashville Baptist Association. He is married with 5 children and 10 grandchildren. You got me beat by a lot. And is currently pastoring a church in Tennessee near Nashville. And I've been there. I preached for you a while back. Wonderful little church. I think I told you I felt at home there. I felt like the people liked us. I felt like I was part of the family.
Great congregation.
And,
great.
And I would encourage anybody in the Tennessee area, or if you're on vacation in Nashville, look this guy up. Is there a way they can find your church? Is it on the internet or anything?
Yes, they can go to a website. Just look for Westview Baptist Church in Kingston Springs, and if you Google that, you'll find it.
Westview Baptist Church, Kingston.
Kingston Springs, Tennessee.
Kingston Springs, Tennessee.
Just outside of Nashville, about 8-10 miles outside.
All
of
right.
Nashville.
So if you're in the Nashville area, look him up if you're looking to visit a church while you're down there on vacation or something. And so what else can you tell us about Pastor Sheldon? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I didn't get saved till I was 31 years old. That was 40 years ago. I came to Nashville to try to make it in the music business, but the Lord got a hold of me instead, and thank God that He did. He called me to preach shortly thereafter, and so I've been a bivocational pastor quite a lot of the last 40 years, but for the last 23 years, I've been pastor at Westview Baptist Church, and like you said, I've got a lovely wife who's my great helpmate.
We've met her. I gave some thought to bringing her on and let her explain.
Oh, no, we don't want to do that.
She'd take over. No, she's a wonderful lady. My wife and I got to meet both of you and went out to eat with you. Oh, had a wonderful time.
Oh, thank you. We enjoyed your visit.
Well, let's jump into this book, and everybody get your hard hats on and your armor on, because we're going to talk about some heavy stuff here. I want to read something on page 135. I think this is the center of your whole book right here, and in fact, that's what you say. You got a verse here. This is chapter 11 called A Cup of God's Wrath. And it talks about the wrath of God being poured out. I'm not going to read the whole verse, but Rex, maybe you put it on the screen. Chapter 14 of Revelation, verse 10. And talking about the wrath of God being poured out. This is rough stuff right here. Without mixture. In other words, it's not even watered down. It's the wrath of God. It's like vodka with no tonic in it. Mm. Not that I'm promoting vodka, but it's not watered down. The wrath of God. And tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And you wrote this down below that. You said there is not much fire and brimstone preaching anymore. Good men of God who are willing to tackle the subject are met with resistance. So tell us about that. In your mind, a lot of preachers are not talking about hell anymore.
So even the lost world knows they're not talking about hell. I remember one Easter, the Tennessean newspaper out of Nashville, Tennessee, they talked about on Easter Sunday morning, the headline was, Hell is Not a Hot Topic Anymore. So even the lost world knows we're not talking about hell. We're not talking about this real devil that is out to destroy us. We've fallen into some you can never exhaust the teaching of God's grace and mercy and love. And anybody who's called to preach, you know, that's our calling. And we all try to do it, but we are responsible to give the whole character of God. We're not responsible to put people in the pews. We are responsible to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and let God put people in the pews such as are being saved. And what the Lord has done is he's given you and me a couple of ways to do that. Certainly, the love of God is incredible. God is love.
Yep.
We could never, ever exhaust that teaching. Never. But Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians, "Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men." In the first letter to Corinthians, he talked about the love of God in chapter 13.
Mm-hmm.
But here he is in the second letter talking about the terror of the Lord. That's what really jumped out at me many years ago when the Lord started impressing this upon my heart. Jude said, on some have compassion,
mm-hmm.
but on others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire. So it seems that there are two ways that people respond to God. One, they respond to the grace and mercy of God, but some don't. And so those people need to understand the judgment that's coming.
Right.
This book, in a way, is a prophetic book in the sense that it is pointing toward the judgment that's coming to each individual at the last day of their life. You know, we're appointed mm-hmm. It's appointed unto the man once to die, and then the judgment. But it's also about the judgment to come on all of mankind, like you're reading out of Revelation 14.
Now, you mentioned that newspaper, and it just so happens that was where I was going next. In your introduction to the book, by the way, when I get somebody's book, of course, I look at the back first to see what it's about. And let me read a little bit about the back cover here, maybe it'll help you. Expanding our understanding of the character and nature of God broadens our concept of God, who is merciful and willing to forgive sinners, yet who is just and by no means will clear the guilty. The Apostle Paul penned these words in his second letter to the Corinthian church. In his first letter, he talked about the love of God in chapter 13. In the second letter, he focused on the terror of the Lord, just as you just said. Within the pages of this book, you will learn the full meaning of the full meaning of wickedness as God defines it, why the cup of God's wrath is about to be poured out. See, that's prophetic. There is a time that God's wrath is getting ready to completely be poured out on this earth, and it's going to begin after we're taken out of here at the rapture. Revelation 6 is clear. The wrath of God takes place not at the middle, but at the beginning of the tribulation.
At the beginning, yes.
It's the whole seven-year period.
Yes.
Now, obviously, it gets worse as it goes. And, of course, you get to the last vials of the judgment, the last where he pours the vials upon the earth. I call them the cups of the wrath of God.
And, exactly.
That's where it's really focused on. You got here, the Lord's judgment is literal and is coming soon. How far the teachings of today have strayed from the true gospel, the devices that Satan uses to deceive even the church, what the fear of the Lord really means, the judgment reserved for those who rejected God's Son, and the cost to those who have remained lukewarm. Amazing. In your title there, The Terror of the Lord, your subtitle is interesting because I just did a show, I think a week or two ago, about faith and expanding our understanding. In fact, maybe it's a future show that hasn't aired yet, but I talk about faith. And I said that in Bible college, I heard a definition for faith. One of my professors said, faith is the knowledge of a person. And I didn't understand it then. I was young. I remember I wrote it down and I thought about it. I understand it now. Because faith is believing God will do what he said he will do. That's what faith is. And you hit it with this thing here, understanding the character of God. To have faith in God, you have to know him. You have to know what he can do and who he is.
Amen.
And you bring that out in the book about the terror of the Lord, expanding our understanding of the character. And yes, he's a God of love, but he's also a God of judgment and a God of justice and a God of wrath.
And the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning
That's
of
right.
wisdom. It's the beginning of knowledge. It's
yeah.
what brings us to him.
Right? Now, in the beginning of the Bible, when Adam was commanded not to eat of something, it seems to me God didn't start with the love angle, did he? He said, lest you die.
Amen.
God put the fear in him, said, look, look at him. You see that tree right there? Don't eat of that tree, because if you eat of that tree, he didn't say, don't eat of it because I love you so much. He said, don't eat it because if you eat it, you'll die.
And here's the deceit of Satan there. He made Adam and Eve think that that was the best tree in the garden.
Yeah.
And it was the worst tree in the garden.
Yeah.
And the Lord is trying to tell us when he warns us, I'm not trying to take something away from you that is better than you can possibly imagine. I'm trying to take something away from you that will destroy you and lead you to utter destruction.
Now, let's be a little blunt here for our viewers. We're preachers.
Amen.
I mean, I'm a preacher like you are. And when we tell the young ladies in our church to stay pure, and we have rules about dating alone and stuff like that. I don't know where you are on some of this, but my children, we had rules about that. If they went on, if, and I don't even like dating, I like the courting thing, but my daughters would never be alone with a boyfriend. That's not because we don't love them. It's because we do love them.
Exactly.
And we know that the consequences of playing with temptation. Listen, I was young. I was a teenager. I got red blood in me. I know the desires that I had as a young man. And we've got to have walls. We've got to have safety. And you brought that out so perfectly in your little illustration there, why God didn't want Adam to eat that fruit. It's not because it's because he did love him, and he didn't want him to be destroyed.
Exactly.
And Satan comes along and says, you know, God knows if you eat that, you'll be as God. You know, God's lying to you.
And he's telling him there'll be no destruction.
Yeah.
And yet the Bible says, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Well, we do know the terror of the
yeah.
Lord. We understand how awful falling into the hands of a living God is if you have not given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. I wish that we were saying it more. You know, Leonard Ravenhill, in his great book, Why Revival Tarries, says we got too many dead men in the pulpits preaching too many dead sermons to too many dead people, and everybody goes home dead.
I read that in your book, and I thought, because I read that book many, I've read it many times, powerful book.
Powerful book.
Every pastor should read that book.
That's right.
Leonard Ravenhill.
Ravenhill.
What's the name
Ravenhill.
Of it?
Ravenhill. Why Revival Tarries.
Why Revival Tarries. That's right. Awesome book. Awesome book. Very convicting book. As I got sidetracked here, I was talking about the introduction. When I pick up a book and I want to see if I like it, of course I look at the back. What's this book about? I might want to know who the guy is. Is he a wacko? Do I want to read this guy? And you did okay on that. But then the introduction, because I'm an author, I write books, and my introduction kind of is a summary of what it's supposed to be an attention getter. Do I want to read this book? So I read your introduction and I highlighted some stuff here, and I want to read a little bit of this just so folks can get it. You said there needs to be a declaration of his terror by those who know him to those who know him not. In other words, those that know the Lord need to tell those who don't know the Lord about his terror. We who know him are neglecting to warn people of the consequences of taking God too lightly.
Yeah, I think we're preaching too lightly, we're witnessing too lightly, we're living too lightly, we're praying too lightly. So consequently, the world's taking God too lightly.
Yeah, and boy, I got a big star here next to that, and you just quoted what I'm getting ready to read right here.
I wrote it.
Yeah, and this was powerful. I put a big star there because I liked it. And it says, whole congregations attend church Sunday after Sunday without ever hearing words like sin, judgment, or hell. Ministers and leaders teach year after year, never touching on phrases like the anger of the Lord, the fear of the Lord. We teach, and here's what you just, we teach too lightly, we preach too lightly, and we pray too lightly. And the result is the world takes God too lightly. That's powerful.
Mm.
Now, you left that part off right there. That's the result of teaching too lightly, preaching too lightly, and praying too lightly is the world takes God too lightly. That
yeah.
would have fit in Ravenhill's book right there.
Amen.
That would have been a great quote of his, but it's your quote. And that's powerful. Do you want to comment on that?
Well, It seems to me that the world, obviously the world has no idea of what's coming. They don't believe in hell. They don't believe in sin. They just think everybody's in some boat together, and so we're all going to end up in some good boat together somewhere else at some time. They don't get the terror of the Lord. And it's we, knowing the terror of the Lord, are to be persuading them. And part of the way that you do that is to tell them about the terror of the Lord. Tell them about the anger of God. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and his wrath is kindled but a little.
Now, have you noticed, and I talked to somebody about this recently, I don't remember who it was or where, but I talked about the Christmas shows now, and like Hallmark, and I'm not bashing Hallmark, and I'm putting down, they got some good stuff, I'm not saying they don't, but have you noticed there's never any gospel in it? It's all lovey-dovey stuff. I mean, even the Christmas lineup they have, there's no Jesus in it.
Mm-hmm.
And there's never any... There's never any mention of sin. It's all lovey-dovey stuff. And it's because the pulpits have stopped.
Exactly.
Have you heard the statement, the pulpits is the conscience of the nation?
Yes.
Yeah, I believe that, and I think you believe that too.
We've got to get back
to that. I know you believe
that.
I've read your book.
We've got to get back to
that. And it's so important that the men of God have got to once again get behind those pulpits and, to be blunt, let it rip. And preach against sin.
Amen.
Preach with love. Preach with a tear in the eye.
Amen. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to share the whole truth.
Yeah.
You can't just share part of the truth. The gospel is offensive. What you're doing with the gospel is you're telling people you're lost and you're going to go and die and go to hell if you don't repent of your sins and turn to the Lord.
Yeah.
And they don't want to hear that. It offends them. No, I'm not that bad or whatever it might be. And it's automatically offensive. So we, in trying to win them, and we do try to win them, we try to get across to them their need for that salvation. So we reach out to them. We talk about love and grace. But at some point, we've got to say there are consequences if you're rejecting this.
There are consequences. And that's what we were getting at with, you know, in my home, the rules we had about our young girls and our young boys, same rule applied for them. They got red blood in their veins.
Amen.
They want to kiss their girlfriend just like I did when I was 16 years old. By the way, I still want to kiss my girl. My wife's my girlfriend. I still want to kiss her. And but there's boundaries that we, if we don't have some boundaries and we don't have some things to protect them, the natural desires of the flesh are gonna be exercised.
And the wages of sin is death. It's gonna bring death to your personality, death to your character, death to the perfect life that the Lord has designed for you. It's gonna be death to all of that.
So love has some love puts some boundaries and some walls around to protect the people that we love.
Amen.
Folks, this is Brother Mark Sheldon. And we're talking to him about his new book, The Terror of the Lord. We barely scraped the surface here. That's the way it always happens. I'll never get to all these things I want to talk to you about. But I hope that you're paying attention, because there's a God in heaven, and he loves you, but that same God is a God of wrath and a God of judgment and a God of justice. We're talking about the God that wouldn't let man be in his presence. Moses wanted to see God, and God said, you can't see me, because in the flesh can no man see God and live. You'd be consumed with his holiness. you can get the book. I'm sure Rex has up on the screen how you can get your copy of the book if you'd like to get one. You can go to the website, prophecynews.com, and you can order it there. Or you can call the 800 number on your screen, and Miss Carol probably will be the one that answers that phone, and she'll take your order over the phone. And we'd love to have you get this. I think I highly recommend this book. I've read it myself personally. A very, very interesting, very sobering book. A book that I wish every preacher would get a copy of this book and get on fire for God again and preach the whole counsel of God.
Amen. Amen.
Well, preacher, let's move on a little here. Let's see how far we can get. I got some things I want to ask you. You say that Jesus preached more about hell or more about heaven?
He talked more about hell than he did heaven. And he even asked the question, who has warned you about the wrath to come?
Yeah.
He says that twice in the Gospels. Who's warned you about the wrath to come? I think that's what this book is trying to say. We need to be warning them, and we need to let them know. People pay attention when warnings come.
Yeah.
God gives warnings.
And again, I hate to keep going back to Genesis, but the chapter two, actually, when God commands Adam not to eat of that tree, that was him warning him.
Amen.
Because he loved him, and he didn't want him to die. And
some people, I think, I don't know, maybe some pastors feel like it doesn't work. But really, the opposite is true. I remember the story of Jonah. Jonah, here's a backslidden preacher. You know the story. He's running from God, and it takes 3 days in the belly of a whale before he even straightens up some. So he finally goes to deliver the message that God has sent him. And his message is 8 words long, something to the effect of yet 40 days and Nineveh yeah. will be destroyed. So he's marching in, and that's all he's saying for 3 days. It took him 3 days to cover the entire Nineveh in distance. And so he's walking in, and he's just saying, in 40 days, it's over for you folks. In 40 days, it's the end. You got 40 days, and that's it. And the whole town gets saved. So they say, perhaps God will repent. Perhaps God will turn back. And so they get in sackcloth and ashes, and they repent before the Lord. And sure enough, the Lord stays the judgment. And it's 100 years later before he ever brings that judgment. There's nothing in Jonah's sermon about grace and mercy.
Right.
There's nothing in his sermon, no three-point message on how to get through life. There's none of that stuff that we like to get into, and I've been as guilty as anybody sometimes in doing that. But the issue is, he didn't give them any offer of love, grace, and mercy, yet God gave love, grace,
right.
and mercy because it was implied. Why was it implied? It was implied because he gave the warning.
Right. Why give the warning?
Why
if there's
give
not
the warning?
A way to rectify it?
Well, that's exactly right. God is in no obligation to us in His sovereignty to warn us about
now,
anything.
You know what I found interesting as you're talking about Jonah, he's the other extreme, isn't he? Today, everyone's preaching the love of God, but nobody's preaching against sin and judgment and wrath. Jonah was the other extreme. He wanted them to. It's like he wanted them to die and go to hell. And he gave them the warning, and he went away, and he got mad when God decided to spare them and bring grace. He got mad. And he's the other extreme, preaching the wrath of God without the love and the grace of God mixed in with it.
Right. I think we got more of a spirit of what I'd call the spirit of Lot in this world today. Lot sits in the Sodom and Gomorrah, and he doesn't hardly share the gospel. As far as the Bible says, he's saved. He's a righteous man.
Right.
God takes him out of the city before he destroys the city, much like the rapture of the church when he's going to take us out before he destroys and dismantles mankind here on earth. But Lot sat there, and when the angels came and said, we're going to leave, he goes and he preaches basically to his in-laws, his son-in-laws, try to get them to come. And the Bible says they looked
they
at him as if
them.
he was a mock.
Yeah.
He was laughable.
Yeah.
And I think Christianity today, we're trying to live so much in the world and just go along and be kind and loving and hope that somehow by osmosis, the people next to us are going to get it.
And preachers are losing their family like Lot did because they're not preaching the whole counsel. And they're not preaching the warnings about living in sin. Even I'm talking about the Christians now. Christians need to have boundaries and warnings and, you know, because there's built-in judgments, not the wrath of God, but there's built-in judgment for sin,
mm-hmm.
even for the Christian.
The wages of sin
you
is
know,
death.
When a man commits adultery as a Christian, there's consequences.
Right.
I mean, just look around. There's awful consequences everywhere you look. Well, listen, that brought us into something else here that I think we need to deal with here. Why, and you got the question in your book, why do preachers stay away from even mentioning it? Why do people not want to hear it? And you said the answer to that is the answer to the second question is, and I highlighted this in the book, people don't preach about the consequences and the judgment and the wrath because it's uncomfortable. I thought that was a powerful statement. Do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I think that's one of the reasons that they don't do it. It's uncomfortable.
Now, what do you mean by uncomfortable?
Well, it sets the preacher up as a judge.
Yeah.
He is now making a judgment on activities, on what's right and what's wrong, and it sets him up as a judge. What the remedy to that for any preacher, I think, is to realize you are just proclaiming the Word of God.
Right.
And that's your job. Proclaim the Word of God. The love will come through to the ones that need to hear the love of God. It obviously did in Nineveh. We need to be preaching what God wants us to preach. I think we're getting a lot of churches today. They try to find out what the congregation wants to hear, and then that's what they give them. But that isn't our job. Our job is to give them what God wants us to give
them. The whole counsel of God. You know, Jeremiah and Ezekiel, they thus saith the Lord. They didn't give them their words. They gave them what God told them
Amen.
To say.
Amen.
And look, preacher out there, if you're not willing to do that, you ought to get out of the ministry. I'm serious. If you're not willing to preach what thus saith the Lord, you ought to go get a job. Go be a salesman somewhere. Get an honest job if you're not going to preach what God said. And we're just about out of time, but I do want to hit something else here. You talk about God's terror and God's love. God's terror and his love collided the day of his son's crucifixion. We'll get into this more in the next week. We'll have you back. But you talk about the fact that there's God's wrath and his mercy on display on the cross. And we probably don't have time to get into that much, but just say a word about that.
Well, one of the things that the way I would answer that is this book is not calling us back to some old form of legalism. It's both. It's trying to get to them with the grace of God and the love of God, the mercy of God, but also to understand there are consequences for your sin, and the Bible says he will in no wise clear the guilty. I don't think people hear that. They hear about the love of God a lot to the point they just are apathetic and probably are even led to believe that in the end God's got some plan to make them all right no matter what.
And so on the cross, you had the Lord Jesus Christ suffering the wrath of God. Of course, Isaiah says it pleased the Lord to bruise him. Folks, we're talking to Brother Sheldon. Brother Sheldon here with his new book, The Terror of the Lord. And we're out of time, but I do want to admonish you, if you don't know the Lord, you've got something to be in terror about. Because if you're not saved, you're going to face the wrath of God in hell, in the lake of fire. We don't want that for you. I hope that... That if you're out there today and you're listening and you don't know for sure you're saved, I hope you'll call the 800 number on your screen or get a hold of somebody. I hope you'll get on your knees and confess to the Lord that you're a sinner and that you deserve to go to hell. But you know that Jesus died for you. I pray that you'll right now invite Jesus Christ, trust in him to save you so that you won't have to suffer the wrath and that you can experience the love of God. Thanks for watching today, and we'll see you next time. Keep looking up.